Hello everyone, good afternoon. I'll be talking about client-side response caching using Vault Agent. I am Vishal Nayak. I am working for HashiCorp for more than 3 years now, and I am on the Vault team. Even though the title says response caching, I will be talking about many more things today. We'll be talking about basically these items. The first one we'll talk about is the secure introduction, and then we'll move on to talk about what a Vault agent is, and then we'll see the auto auth feature of Vault agent and what problem does it solve. And then we'll move on to define another problem space of Vault getting potentially loaded due to misconfigured clients. And then we'll talk about the secret caching feature of Vault agent that solves that problem. Secret introduction basically defines the problem space, and then the auto auth feature tries to solve that. Let's see how that's all done. These are the goals for the talk today. At the end of this talk, I hope that all the applications and services really stop worrying about how to get Vault tokens altogether. And then zero token maintenance by all the applications. Applications and services should not and need not worry about how to maintain a Vault token. And then we will see that once the credentials and the token is received by the applications, how to make sure that it's used in the way that how HashiCorp recommends it. And we'll also see one way wherein applications can use Vault tokens but never really need to see that. Let's dive into what secure introduction is. We all know Vault is good at keeping secrets. It stores everything encrypted. It issues only secrets to those people who have access to it. Everything is encrypted, everything is good. But the main catch is that everybody needs a Vault token in order to get anything done from Vault. Everything is centralized, but everything needs a token. Secure introduction is a problem space, essentially, wherein all the applications and services somehow need to get hold of this first Vault token. If the services are running in GCP or AWS or Kubernetes or name it, they all need a Vault token to operate. So secure introduction essentially is the secret zero problem, how to get that first Vault token. After getting the first Vault token, services and applications should also make sure that the token is alive and healthy. Tokens usually will have a time to live on it. So before the time to live is hit, applications and services should renew the token frequently until the maximum TTL is hit. So if that is not done, the token will get invalidated and becomes a bad token. There are various authentication methods to get a Vault token. You can use AWS identity to establish the AWS credentials to get a Vault token. You can use Okta credentials to get a Vault token. You can use a RADIUS authentication credentials to get a Vault token, LDAP, and many more authentication methods to get a Vault token. And the logic to keep the Vault token may not be straightforward, particularly when there are hundreds and thousands of applications. Getting Vault token, they all need to stop worrying about whatever they are doing and then switch to a mode wherein they need to worry about how to take care of the tokens that they already fetched from Vault. After taking a look at this problem, HashiCorp started an internal project to solve it somehow. They called it Vault Secure Introduction. What it basically did was it ran as a daemon on the AWS instance, and then got the AWS EC2 instance metadata, took the PKCS7 signature of that, sent it to Vault, got it authenticated, and fetched the Vault token. And if you ran the Vault secure introduction binary on an AWS EC2 instance, services need not worry about getting a Vault token. But we knew that this was not a full-fledged project, and we also knew that this was supposed to be on the open source side and not on the enterprise side, which it was. Going forward, so this all translated to become Vault Secure Introduction became Vault Agent going forward. Vault Agent is basically a client-side helper that is used to interact with the Vault server on behalf of the clients and applications. This was introduced way back in 0.11. This runs as a client-side daemon. And the good thing is that it is part of the Vault binary, and you don't have to download another binary or anything. This is just a mode in which Vault runs. Let's talk about the auto-auth feature that tries to solve the secret introduction problem. Essentially, in the auto-auth mode, Vault agent will read the configuration file and then see where it is being run on, whether it is being run on AWS, GCP, or if it's using any other JOT authentication method or app role authentication method. And based on those credentials, it will interact with Vault and invokes the login API and gets the Vault token. And on top of that, Vault's Go SDK already provides a way to keep the tokens renewed on the client side, but not everyone uses it. So Vault agent already uses this feature to keep the token renewed all the time. Another problem is after the token hits its maximum time to live, it needs to be re-authenticated, and services cannot take care of all this responsibility, particularly when there are hundreds and thousands of applications running. AutoAuth currently supports AliCloud, AWS, GCP, Kubernetes, and many more authentication methods. Let's see how AutoAuth configuration works. It's a very simple configuration file. We can see that there is an AutoAuth block at the top, and that has two things. One is the method, and the second one is the sync. First one defines where the agent is being run. In this case, we are using app role as the authentication method. App role is an authentication method which is very similar to the username password way of authentication, but it's just that this is meant for the machines to authenticate themselves. In this case, app role authentication is enabled on the Vault server, and then a role is created on it. And against that role, we create what we call as a secret ID. The ID of the role serves as the username, and the secret ID that we create serves as the password. All that orchestrations will do is to ensure that the role ID is already known by the applications beforehand, and during the service startup, somehow the secret ID is injected into the service so that service can use both the role ID and the secret ID to interact with Vault and get the Vault token. In this case, we are telling Vault agent to do it on behalf of the client. And the second block is the sync block. Sync essentially tells the agent where to dump the Vault token that it got from the Vault server. In this case, it is explaining that the type is of file and the path name of the file where it needs the token to be output to. One important thing about syncs is that sync can be multiple, so it can be used as a fan-out feature, wherein different services and applications are looking for different files they want to look into for Vault token, and Vault token magically appears in those files. Sorry? Yeah, I'll come to that. Let's take a look at how it all works. The green block that you see is the client side, and the gray block is for the Vault server side. The application will not do anything. The agent automatically reads the configuration and sees the method and the sync defined in the configuration file, interacts with Vault, and gets the Vault token back. After getting that token, it dumps it in the sync defined in the configuration file. And then the application will only need to look at the sync, take the token, and use it to interact with Vault directly. And in this case, the client does not need to implement authentication and token renewal logic at all, and the agent will take care of doing that. Let's do a demo, and let us see how it all works. First, we'll run a Vault server, and then we'll enable the app role authentication method, create an app role ID and a secret ID that we saw, and then configure agent and have it fetch a Vault token automatically. Is the font visible? All right. Here, we are killing the existing vault process, if there was any. This command starts the vault server. And then vault auth enable app role. This enables the app role authentication method. This command creates a role, and then immediately followed by that, we create a secret ID against that role, and we read out the role ID. Now we have vault server running, app role authentication enabled. We have role ID and the secret ID fetched. We take those two credentials and dump it to these two files. Then we move on to configuring the agent. In the agent, this is exactly the one that we saw on the slide. This has an auto auth block, which has the method as app role, and the role ID file path, and the secret ID file path. These two are the same files where we dumped the secret ID and the role ID. Sync is a file, and it is writing to temp app role token. And the next block is vault, which tells the agent where vault server is actually running. And then we simply begin the agent. In this one, I'll run the script that we just saw. And in this one, we'll be watching the sync file. Let's look at the logs. I ran the agent. The agent is now running in background. If we take a look at the logs, agent created a file sync, and then it started authentication. It initiated the authentication. Authentication was successful. It started the sync server and wrote the file to the sync. Also, we need to see one more thing. The tokens that we are creating has a TTL of 3 seconds, which means that within 3 seconds, this token needs to be renewed by the service asking for the token. And after 10 seconds, this token will get invalidated regardless of renewal. So agent will need to ensure that it roughly takes about 3 to 4 renewals or 5 renewals in case of jitter and backoff with the backoff logic. And then after roughly about 10 seconds, it needs to re-authenticate and fetch a new token. In the logs, we can see that the agent renewed the token roughly about 5 times, and then renewer said it is done. And then the agent started to re-authenticate, and the token was returned to the sync again. In order to take a look at how this is working, we can look at this window. I don't know if you are able to see it. OK. If you take a look at this part, every 10 seconds, this switches to a new token. Yeah, it changed now. So that was vault agent in action and how it used app role authentication method to talk to vault and get a new token. And continuously does that every time the token hits its max TTL. Let's move on to another problem statement, which is we saw that agent was creating the token. Up until recently, before HashiCorp introduced something called as batch tokens. Before that, all the tokens that was created by Vault used to hit storage. Batch tokens is intentionally and designed to not hit storage and be very lightweight. But outside of that, all the regular tokens, not batch tokens, we call it service tokens now, and that is expensive. The reason I call it expensive is because when a token is created, it needs to store itself, and it has multiple indexes along with it. It has something called as a parent index, and it has a token's accessor. And if replication is in play, all the data will also be replicated in the write-ahead logs that we use for replication to work. So it gets replicated there. And then if DR replication is also in action, all the things that are in the primary cluster are also replicated on the secondary cluster. That means that all these things will be replicated to the secondary as well, and those many storage writes will go there. This is the same case with dynamic credential creation as well. Even though dynamic credential creation does not result in a lot of storage writes, it does result in an active lease and a timer being maintained in memory. What it essentially means is that in order to revoke the lease and the dynamic credentials that Vault issues, it maintains a timer and tracks it in memory all the time until it is done. So even if Vault goes down, it remembers all those leases. If you bring Vault up, it will restore all the leases and keep it in memory. So if there are too many dynamic credentials that are created, that can become a problem. Usually Vault scales to a very large degree. It fails to address the problem only when the clients are misconfigured. What do I mean when I say misconfigured clients? One of the customers we had was running into a problem wherein it had thousands of services requesting for Vault tokens with every action that it was taking every time. And the detail of that token was much larger. So the tokens used to live in memory, all the active leases of the token used to live in memory, and the services were creating tokens every time continuously. Obviously, this led to a problem wherein the memory was getting choked, the storage was getting choked, the instances were not responsive, Vault became unresponsive. The problem was exactly this. Instead of reusing the tokens that the clients received in the first place, all the applications used to get and request new token with every other action that it did. So as a solution to this, the Vault team developed Vault agent caching as a solution to address this problem. The idea was to make sure that agent was anyways running as a daemon and used to authenticate with Vault. Why not convert that daemon into a full-fledged server and consume entire Vault API? Clients and applications will not ever need to talk to Vault server directly. It simply points to the agent itself. An agent will have a listener of its own, and it forwards the request to the Vault server and then somehow ensure that the responses are even though the clients are misconfigured, return only those responses that it needs at the point and not create a fresh one every time. It essentially proxies all the requests and manages the responses. We will see what agent does with the responses. It does not need to deal with all the responses, but it has something to do with some responses. This is the scope of the agent caching. It only caches those secrets that are long-lived and has an expiration. There are only two things in Vault as of today that needs this. One is tokens, and the other one is leases. When I say leases, it's dynamic credential generation, DB passwords, AWS credentials, anything of that sort. Anything that generates in a lease. If you have PKI certificates generating lease, that will also generate, fall under this same problem space. Agent basically takes the responses, and majority of the responses are simply a pass-through. But if it is a token and or a lease, it caches that. So the next time client asks for the same secret, it will see that, oh, the same client, does it already have a valid lease and a valid token, whatever it is asking for, in the cache? And if yes, we return it. Reading KV secrets are also not cached because it does not create tokens and leases. But we have plans to make sure that this can also be supported. There are some underpinnings that we are working on that can enable this, but right now agent cannot do it. Let's see how agent caching is configured. It's pretty simple. We need to make sure that agent runs as a server. There are three things that needs to be done. One, add a cache block to let the agent know that it needs to run in the cache mode as well. And the second one is a listener, and we basically tell what to listen on to. TCP, it supports two things, TCP and Unix socket at this point. And the last thing is Vault Agent ADDR. So we already know about Vault ADDR, which the applications will use. But this time, if you set Vault Agent ADDR, CLI will already know that override the Vault ADDR address and refer to Vault Agent address and send the requests to Vault Agent instead of the Vault server. There is one caveat. I'll delve into a little bit of implementation detail to explain this, but I'll also hopefully justify why I explained the implementation detail to explain this point. Essentially, the agent looks at the HTTP request as it is. It, along with the request headers and the body, it serializes everything into a blob and then hashes that to create a consistent string for a particular request and uses that string as an index into the cache to identify unique requests from the applications. The problem is that if the request parameters or anything, any parameter, even though the request is the same, if the order of the request parameters or the headers is modified, it results in a different serialized blob, hence it results in a different hashed value, and hence the index will change. So agent will think that it's a unique request, not a cached one already, and makes another request to Vault server and gets a different credential. But this was experimental. There are some other approaches that we are trying out. We wanted to try this out and see how it works in practice. It looks like this is not hurting as much as we thought it would. Applications are making similar requests all the time. We have not run into any issue, but we certainly have plans to improve this workflow. How does agent know how to evict the cache entries? So this is a tricky problem. The problem exists because agent has no way to know what Vault server is doing. It needs to make an API request to actually check with Vault server and see if the token is revoked or not. Another problem is if the applications and clients interact with Vault directly and without the agent know about the interaction that happened with the Vault server, agent will never know to invalidate the cache. So it does two things. One is if the renewer in the agent, which is taking care of both the tokens and the leases, if that is completed, it knows that the cache invalidation needs to be done and it evicts the entries from the cache. Second one is it tries to do some best effort thing wherein it tries to see what the request is. If the request is to revoke a token, it'll know that anyways the client and the application is asking for the token to be revoked. Let's forward the request to the Vault server. Look at the response. If it is successful, let's invalidate the cache. And the same is the case for lease invalidation as well. Can this be improved? Here's a little sneak peek into what might be coming in the future, but don't take it as granted. We are thinking of ways wherein there is a notification method that which clients can subscribe to and get updated for. So if such a thing lands, then this can be certainly be improved because cache invalidations, all this best effort will become certain effect. And then, what happens when a user is granted a new policy? What I mean to say here is that an application has already gained a token from the Vault agent, and the operator of Vault issues a new permission to that user and requests that user to get a new token in order to get those new access to some of the resources in Vault. But when that application makes a request to the agent, it gets the same old token that it already had and not get the new token. So in that case, the same operator can also tell the same application bust the cache using the cache clear API. This is achieved because when we make an entry into the cache, we make sure that we use multiple indexes to do it. When a response is cached, we index that entry based on which token resulted in that response, which token accessor resulted in that response, which API request path was the request making in order to get this response. So based on all those factors, you can bust the cache entries. So in this case, if the new policy is granted to a user, that user can hit this API is active only on the agent and not on the Vault server because it affects only to the cache maintained by the agent. So hit this API on the agent and supply that token that will be invalidated and make a request again, that application will get a new token. Something to remember. If tokens expire, all the leases that were created by the token also expires. This is a general Vault philosophy, and this is how Vault works. This has nothing to do with agent, but there may be consequences when agent is put to play, people should be mindful that all the tokens and leases that are created and maintained by the agent will be, if the renewal of the agent is stopped, if the agent is brought down, eventually all those leases and all those tokens will expire. This is applicable for auto-auth tokens as well. Something to keep in mind is that when the agent goes down, all the tokens will not get invalidated automatically. It will only stop the renewal process. It does not mean that all the tokens are revoked automatically. So all these leases will eventually expire, not immediately after the agent is brought down. Let's see if there are any security concerns. Primarily, we believe in the zero trust philosophy. And in the same way, an agent does not have any permissions to talk to Vault server whatsoever. It only has those permissions to access the Vault server as much as the client had with the credentials that it provided using the auth method. Agent does not persist anything to storage. Everything lives in memory, which is why when Vault server goes down and comes back up, it restores all the token leases and the secret dynamic credential leases, but the agent will not do it. We cannot rely on hitting storage. And answering to one of the questions that was posed by a gentleman here, Sync currently has support for dumping things to file, but we are thinking of doing the same for Unix sockets as well. But we have seen that people are using tempfs and ramfs instead of the storage directly. So that way, the credentials never leave the memory of the application and the service where it is running. And even if the agent is not there, anyways, the application would have fetched the token and kept it wherever it intended to be. Instead, if people begin to use this, operators can decide where the tokens will go, generally speaking. And there is this neat another feature that we thought could change things for good. This makes sure that, earlier I made a statement that anything and everything needs a Vault token to interact with Vault. This feature enables applications and services to never see a Vault token at all in its lifetime. This is achieved by setting this flag, use auto auth token equals true to the cache block. What it does is that when applications make requests to the Vault agent, it sees that the request does not have a Vault token on it. And the configuration for agent says, use the auto auth token. So if there is no request, agent will automatically stick the auto auth token to the request and then forwards the request to Vault server. Earlier, we were in a world wherein services needs to do some juggling to provide identity to get the tokens, and then do some more juggling in order to maintain those tokens by renewing it and then re-authenticating it, and then do some more juggling to distribute that tokens to all the other applications that needed it. Now we are moving into a mode wherein they do not ever have to worry about getting the Vault token, renewing them, and storing them. All these problems can be completely offloaded to agent. Let's look at agent cache using a diagram. The gray block above depicts the Vault server, and the green block below is Vault on the client side, Vault agent on the client side. The application, instead of talking to Vault server, it requests a lease or a token to the Vault agent. It need not necessarily be a lease or a token. It can be any request, but the response will be a pass-through and cache will be a no-op. Only in case of a lease or a token, if it looks at the cache, and if there is a response already, it returns it back. If not, the request is forwarded to the Vault server. Vault server returns the lease or the token requested by the app, and then stores it in the cache and returns it back to the application. And then application can choose to directly talk to Vault using that token, and then use the DB credential as well. Let's look at a demo for this as well. This is the same, exactly the same as the previous demo. We run a Vault server, enable the app role authentication method, run the agent, and then after running the agent, we make a request to the agent to create a token. And then we create the same request, we make the same request in quick succession 2-3 times and make sure that the response is received, the response received is always the same. It's the same script, kills the vault server, starts the vault server, enables the app role authentication, reads out the secret ID and the role ID. But I have given the TTL as 5 minutes, in this case instead of 3 seconds. Dumps the role ID and secret ID to files. This is the exact same configuration that we saw for auto auth. These are the two things enabling the caching feature. Cache block lets the agent know that to run in the cache mode. Use auto auth token equals true can be set in this one. And then this is the listener that we are defining, similar to how vault server does it. Mention an address where it needs to run and the port number. And then start the agent. After starting the agent, we are fetching a different role ID and a secret ID. The role ID and secret ID mentioned above is for the auto auth, and this is an explicit request being made to the agent. That is enabled by Vault Agent ADDR. So we are pointing to 8007, which is the port where agent is running. And then we make three consecutive login requests. Let's run this script and see how it works. We just ran the script. The script has run successfully. Agent is running. And in the agent, we see that auto auth was successful. And then cache received a request to create a secret ID. And then it received a request to create a role ID. Responses will not be cached in this case. And then it received three consecutive login requests. And in the response, the output of the script, we can see that for all these three login requests, the token received is the same. So that's agent caching in action. To recap, we looked at what secure introduction problem is, wherein how do all the applications initially establish their identity and interact with Vault to get a Vault token, and how it is a problem when things are at scale. And we saw Vault, what Vault agent is, why did it come to existence, and what auto auth feature does to solve the problem of secure introduction. And then we discussed about the problem of how misconfigured clients can potentially overload Vault with too many unnecessary requests, and how agent caching tries to solve that. I really hope that people transition to use agent and ensure the workflows wherein services never see a Vault token. The demos and the scripts that you saw are pushed to this link. All it needs is a Vault binary to be stuck there, and then you can run it and see exactly what we ran. The one difference and the catch is that the agent works with some of the response tags for the token creation, which initially was not present. It was introduced in Vault 1.1, so it's best if people use Vault 1.1 and above to run these scripts and generally use Vault agent in caching mode. That's all I had for the talk, and this is a talk which my colleague is giving tomorrow. His name is Clint, and he'll be talking about secure introduction on Kubernetes and how you can use the service account tokens to interact with Vault and get a token, how you can run it as a sidecar, how to inject secrets in the pods. I hope that you'll also stop by to that talk and know how secure introduction is solved with Kubernetes. It's only for service tokens. That's a question I can answer, but probably I'll head down and talk to you backstage. Thank you.